Good morning from all around the world. I'm broadcasting directly from the Cardiac Catheterization Laboratory at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York. My name is Pedro Moreno. I'm Professor of Medicine, Interventional Cardiologist, and I will be your moderator today. We'd love to hear from you, so please send us all your questions using the website or the YouTube. Today, we have a modification in our program. We have a very important case that has a lot of teaching for clinicians around the world, and Dr. Sharma will explain. Go ahead, Dr. Sharma.
All right. Good morning to our webcast viewers, and there is a little change in our case. This will be the first in the 36 cases we have done. What we announced, e-blast, we were able to perform the case. The case which we announced last week, what happened is patient early morning woke up at 4 o'clock and 8. And you, clearly for anesthesia point of view, it has to be at least 6 to 8 hours of empty stomach. So we had to reshuffle our case. But at the same time, we have another very educational case, which I will be discussing today. As a case number 37. And I just want to introduce my team members here. Left side is Dr. Keeney, then Dr. Gilbert Tang, right is Parushram, our new structural attending. Then we have two fellows, Sunny and Faisal. On the echo side, we have Dr. Larakis. And we on the our cardiac anesthesia is
the slide.
Is our Eric Fried. So with that note, let's go to the slides so that we go through this case. Faculty involved in the, and all the disclosures are clearly, everyone is expert for this purpose. And of course, Pedro Moreno with extensive experience will be moderating the case. And so the case number 37 is a 61-year-old patient who has progressive dyspnea and fatigue for last few months, and also alcohol abuse, has a cirrhosis, and also has a CKD stage between 3 and 4. Creatinine runs about 2 to 3. And clearly, rest of the things which we'll be showing you on echocardiogram, more importantly, patient also has a fall in ejection fraction, which used to be normal until last year, became 33%, and has a low flow, low gradient, severe AS, and we'll ask Dr. Larakis to comment on it with a SVI of 22 ml per meter square. And coronaries are normal in this particular case. So this is the echo. And I think if we can pause here and go to the live echo, please. And Stem Larakis, yes, Stem, yes. You tell us about what you are seeing in your live echo.
Yes.
Once they bring echo, yes.
Yes, so the ejection
fraction. Put the echo on the main screen, please.
The ejection fraction, as Dr. Sharma says, about 30-35%. As you can see, the aortic valve is thickened and doesn't open well. A little bit, maybe mild aortic insufficiency. As you can see here, short axis view, the valve doesn't open and thickened and calcified. Ejection fraction again, about 30-35%, little bit pericardial effusion posteriorly. Right ventricle is a little bit down, again 35%. And the aortic valve, as you can see, doesn't open, thickened, calcified. We measure gradients. The peak velocity we got is about 3.1 with a peak gradient of 37 and a mean gradient of 23. And by doing the continuity equation, we get aortic valve area of 0.8 centimeters square and stroke volume index 22 ml per meter square, which is a low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis with a low ejection fraction, as Dr. Sharma say. And this is a subcostal view, as you can see, minimal pericardial effusion and a lot of amount of ascites on the top. That's the echo part, Dr. Sharma.
Okay. So Anu, on this particular case with the cirrhosis and hepatitis, what was the verdict in terms of going forward, a young person who has a low flow, low gradient, calcific aortic stenosis?
Because of, I think, liver disease, actually, Gilbert can talk more on that. When the surgical assessment happened, they felt probably a better candidate for TAVR than a surgeon.
Gilbert?
Yeah, so this patient had a liver cirrhosis, had status with liver transplant on immunosuppressant already. So plus CKD, that's two organ dysfunction. You know, even though a liver transplant is quote unquote normal, it's really not abnormal because the patient is on immunosuppressant. So despite the patient's young age, with patients, you know, we felt that if you can have a less invasive, less chance of bleeding, that would be appropriate.
Okay. And the second, our protocol, patients who have high CKD, stage 3 or 4, that how would you evaluate compared to our usual? We do a CT angio for these patients. So how we have been doing those cases?
Go ahead, Parasam.
Sure. We have been doing a combination of MRI and the MRA and the CT non-con. If the creatinine is not terrible, it's not beyond like 1.5, 1.6, we do a modified low-dose protocol. But in this patient, we had totally a CT non-con along with the MRI and the MRA. That kind of like correlates the calcification on the CT and the vessel lumen and the vessel size on the MRI. So we can actually make a hybrid multimodality imaging to get an idea of the vessel size and where the calcium is to decide which side is actually the main access site. And while we get the access during the procedure, we also usually do not inject contrast and get a peripheral angiogram. We fluorosave the point where the needle enters, and we actually correspond with that to our ProGlide before we actually deploy the plunger, that the ProGlide is right at the point where we enter the site, so that we have an idea like everything is going smooth. We take one peripheral angiogram at the end, at the end of the case, after the big sheet comes, after the closure, to make sure there is enough and adequate hemostasis with no other complications.
Yeah, you want to just show what you did today?
Sure. So
go back to the fluoro, please.
So since it's a 34 evolute valve, we actually had a right IJ tempo lead pacemaker that is actually placed from the neck. And this was our non-main site. Since the patient is actually high risk with a EF of 30-35%, we also get an extra vein in the groin. So that's that. And then that's the arterial entry site in the non-main site of the right. And since we also don't have enough anatomy defined, we have an up and over wire from the contralateral side to balloon tamponade at the end to achieve like dry hemostasis. So that's why we see another wire. And this is the point of entry on the main side, which is the mid femur. And then this is the entry, the same exact, the needle of the ProGlide device actually corresponds to the needle entry. We use two ProGlide devices since we are going to use a 22 French sheath. And that's what we did so far. We also checked the valve to make sure that the paddles and the inflow and outflow are okay.
So just to say, it's very impressive that you're putting such a large sheath just based on the MRA pictures and your clinical fluoroscopic guidance without giving any dye.
Yeah, Dr. Sharma.
I think that's a very commendable. So yeah, you can see it literally, that is the way it has been done. And then second question comes is to where are we going to deploy the valve? And remember, multiple times we give small injections, but do require give an injection to have an adequate and appropriate height of the valve so that it's not too much, too high or too deep. And we actually have published with George Dangas a case series of 7 cases in CCI with the using that Olympic ring, that 3 pigtails in various the sinuses, and that gives you the landmark where the valve should be. So in this particular case, we are doing a modified technique, and this is maybe, and this is the first time we are given a 3 cc's of dye. Maybe Gilbert can highlight that this modification of our 3 Olympic ring with a little different wire today.
Yeah, well, today we didn't use right radial access because the renal issue, and also we didn't think that would be appropriate to use Sentinel in this context. So we only have 2 access. So we have one pigtail on the non-cut. You can see here that we did the injection. We put another wire, J-wire, at the bottom of the right cut to see at the other plane. So there's no need to inject any contrast until at the time of the deployment. That's really the critical aspect. And so we'll do the contrast injection to confirm that we have landed appropriately on all 3 cuts before we release the valve. And this is the modified cut overlap technique that you see RAO caudal that allows a high implantation to avoid pacemaker as well.
And this is interesting that, because remember, so far, 3 cc's of dye have been given. And we probably will give another 3 or 4 here. And last, as Parushram mentioned, will be in the end after the hemostasis, hemostasis has been achieved. So with that note, we are ready to go for our next presentation. Continue our next slide, please. Oh, good. The TT we have spoken about, aortic annulus, so MRI. how accurate it is MRI without contrast CT versus MRI in terms of aortic annulus, because that is the most important point. In the minimum maximum, you see 24.7, 29 large valve annulus with a mean of about 26.8. So just in terms of our experience, how has been that annulus we get on the MRI versus in our usual CAT scan, CT? Yeah.
We compare them MRI with the non-contrast as an estimation. So you can see here, this perimeter is clearly in the 34 evolute range. By area, will be probably an undersized sapien 3. So you know, basically, because of the annulus, and you can see next slide has you know, the sinuses are very large. So because of that, we felt that very comfortable oversizing a 34 evolute, because you don't want to undersize, but that's when you have potential risk of paravalvular leak in this limitation. And you can see also the coronary anatomy are very favorable for either valve, but we felt that because the contrast issue, also the oversizing issue, that the evolute allows to reposition, recapture if we need to. So it's a bit on a safer choice in this particular patient who's clearly a high risk because of the liver and CKD.
Okay. So far, and then this is the non-contrast which showed femoral arterial access, and tremendous job has been done to get the access. We have both, this is 20 French,
22
French on the left side for the Evolute Pro, and the main access, and the right is also 6 French and so. So now question is, which type of valve? Evolute Pro Plus, as remember, Pro is basically the better delivery, and Plus is that pericardial cuff to decrease the paravalvular leak. So Pro, this is based on our annular mean diameter of 26.8 and perimeter of 84.5. That Evolute 34 Pro Plus is the appropriate in this particular case. So summary overall, this is the patient with a lot of comorbid conditions, low flow, low gradient, severe aortic stenosis causing decrease in ejection fraction. And now here for the transfemoral tower using 34 millimeter Evolute Pro Plus core valve via left percutaneous femoral approach, and a sentinel cerebral protection device, we cancelled it because of obvious issues with the giving additional dye and tortuosity. And the purpose is that we are going to do minimal contrast, and in my definition of minimal contrast is that you are in single digits, up to 9 cc's or so. Less than 10 cc will be our goal today. So Anu, now
I think we'll cross the valve.
Okay,
we already
go
have
the fluoro, please.
Yeah, AR two. Lights down a little bit. Yeah. Get a AL1 ready also.
Yeah. The basically is usually AR2 is way to go. Now in this case, it's definitely a horizontal aorta. So we had to be careful with the placement of the 34 Evolute Pro. But yes, once you have the large aorta, usually AL1 compared to AR2, which is the usual, then we go with the AL1. So here, since we have AR2 already, so going to try for a few minutes with the straight Terumo wire, 38, and see. Pedro, any comments and any questions so far?
Yeah, interesting. So in this case, certainly the issue of contrast-induced acute renal failure is a major concern. As such, there are several techniques. The first one will be to evaluate her left ventricular and diastolic pressures to define on the hydration, in which if the LVEDP is normal,
let's say
it's below 12 millimeters of mercury, we use 5 cc's per kilo per hour. This is a big, in 80 cc, in an 80 kilo patient, it's going to be 400 cc's per kilo, 400 cc's per hour for 4 hours. And 3.5 is your LVEDP is between 12 and 18, and 1.5 per kilo if your LVEDP is greater than 18. The other issue is keep in mind your GFR. Your GFR, you know, never go double of your GFR. Two points your GFR is the maximum you can give. Of course, here we're going to do digits, you know, in the single digits will be ideal. But certainly, if you keep your GFR multiplied by 2, you're below that in your contrast volume, you'll be on the safe side with the hydration.
Yeah, absolutely. So clearly, the GFR guided, EDP guided strategies to decrease the contrast nephropathy, as you know, many of them at present ongoing. So clearly, this patient receive hydration.
Yeah.
So I know usually they give normal saline, but I can tell you most of the studies are normal saline, but normal saline is a trouble. All so these cardiac patients go into pulmonary edema. So we give half normal. Sure, I know the data are more for the normal saline, but we usually give half normal saline because just they don't tolerate. I mean, particular cardiac patient. This is a little different. This patient is not a cardiac because coronaries are normal. But any of those patients, if your LV dysfunction is from coronary artery disease, I personally give half normal saline. But as I mentioned that, yes, data have been in terms of using them, most of them are with the normal saline.
So you see, Pedro, which by AL1, it barely took 10 seconds to cross.
Yeah, very
so
good teaching.
The catheter size always depends on the size of the aortic root.
Show them the hemodynamics also, please. It's still good gradient, I mean.
40. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a 40 plus. Yeah, okay. So now, what are the next step you're going to do?
Now we will go with the Confida wire. Huh? Oh, no, let's go with the 300 and change to Pictel.
You can get your EDP there if you want.
Yeah, we got the EDP. Yeah. No, we got EDP is about 18.
18, yeah.
Yeah.
It's an issue.
Yep.
So we'll change to a 300 and go to a Pictel.
Yeah, tell us the reason that why we go to this extra step. You have crossed already. Then why would you not just go with the Confida wire and change it to the Pictel and get to the better position?
Since the wire has to be in mid to apical part of the LV and you want the wire sit well, very important for the deployment of the valve. So that can be only achieved with the Pictel.
Okay. Very good point. So what the important point I just want to say, it looks like an additional unnecessary step, but we using this approach, our LV perforation, particularly patients with a stiff ventricle and a small cavity, has just become minuscule. So key is this is one extra step is needed, but that actually really one it takes away from that it's not going through any chordae and free
the wire back.
And more importantly, that it just make a nice loop on your tower wire, whether it's using whichever wire you using here, Confida or
Safari.
Yeah.
This is important for this patient already on immunosuppressant. So I think it's very important that.
So patients who are risk for LV perforation are three. One is patients who are on the steroid for whatever reasons. Patients on immunosuppression, and we have seen elderly women patients who have small, stiff ventricle. Those are the cases where we will go with the Safari wire. Otherwise, normally we would go with a Confida wire.
Okay.
So this is a Safari wire. You see, it's sitting nicely in the apex, and the curve is very important while the valve is being deployed.
What balloon we are using?
23.
So we do plan to do a BAV with a 23 millimeter Z-Med.
Okay.
Patients with LV dysfunction like this particular case, when you are doing BAV, we could try to do it without pacing.
Yep. Go a little inside. Okay. You move inside. Okay. So that we all three are here. Okay. So we are going to do without pacemaker. This is a 23 millimeter Z-Med. No.
Okay. Stop. Stop.
Okay.
Okay. Stop okay. Pacing.
Stop. No, there was no pacing yet.
It was just PVCs.
Yeah. Let's do pacing now quickly. Because I think it
okay. Go 150 pacer.
Quickly. So see that so much PVCs and keep, sure 25 might have been okay. Pacemaker.
Are you pacing? 150? Okay.
Good.
Good. Pressure didn't go down. Okay.
Still not.
Okay, stop pacing. Actually.
Yeah, good. Now done.
You got
okay.
It.
Okay, good. Good. They start coming out. And once away. Good. Very good. Okay, the valve should be ready. And valve always has to be ready when you're doing a BAV in case severe AI occurs. So valve is always ready because you can't even wait for 1-2 minutes. Good.
Yeah. In case you need to pulse dilate, which balloon are you planning to use, Dr. Kinney?
25.
We have our 26.
I think 26. It should be 26.
Ready. Yeah, it's 26 is ZMAD. Yeah, 60.
There's a little bit of annular calcification as well, so I have to be careful as well when the potential pulse dilation.
One second, yeah.
Good.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I'm going to hold here, and Gilbert is number 2, and I'm 3. Good.
Go ahead.
Okay, show them. This is facing at 3 o'clock,
yeah.
Okay?
Okay, that's 3.
Yeah, 3 o'clock, this. Showed it, yeah. And now you go to your view of deployment.
We'll look at the
so
arch.
We are already there.
No, we'll
but after
the
moving it at the arch.
Yeah, we'll make sure the arch because we don't have Sentinel, but we still need to make sure.
Now we have to make sure you're
yeah,
you're okay.
Good.
Happy
good.
With
yeah.
The C-tab.
Yeah, the hat marker is in
heart
order curve
is
as
good.
You cross the arch. Yeah. And then once you cross the arch into the annulus, we're about to cross the valve, then we
yeah.
can go to the angle.
This is good. Good.
Very nice.
Okay
good. So we take the parallax out like we always do with deployment. Pretty good here.
So Pedro, normally we would like to give a give die and take a cine at this stage, but here we will just use a pigtail.
Yeah, and
when we are
make sure it's the bottom of
yeah.
the pigtail, right, or the root.
Mm.
Okay, 120, please.
We are looking at the calcium.
I think we should
inject.
Sure. No, do you want to inject yet? Not yet, right?
We can see the calcium.
Yeah, good. That's okay. Open a little bit and then we'll see.
Okay.
Go.
Yeah. And that is the key. So you're doing it without
150.
Oh. No, it came out.
We may have to go higher pacing.
Yeah. Very dynamic. You can see the
we saw
so
the
when you're capturing what you need to do is
yeah,
always make sure
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You do it under fluoro and
yeah.
not to include the pigtail.
Mm-hmm. No, blood pressure has to go down a little more.
Yeah.
Let me go in.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Pressure is still very high, even with pacing.
Okay, pacemaker off for the time being?
Yep.
Let it recover.
Eric? Where's the pig?
Off.
Yeah.
Pacemaker off.
Pacemaker off, please. Let's recover something. Wait 2 minutes because a lot have been. Yeah.
Very good.
Okay, you wanted to give some instruction to Eric?
What? Yeah, Eric, get the blood pressure low, okay? We'll wait till the blood pressure goes down.
It's not bad.
I think we need to decrease the lower with the fast pace.
You want pace faster, Dr. Sharma?
No.
Yeah. Okay.
What else can we do? Otherwise, wait 1 second. Let's strategize. In this particular case, the valve is moving. Too much motion. We saw it with the balloon valvuloplasty. And pressure is still high. And we're requesting our anesthesia colleague that to bring it down further. Right now, it's 130 over 80. Maybe we can give a little nitro. Oh, coming down. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, now it's reaching.
Okay. Now, pace at 150. Don't release it. Let's make sure pressure is low. Okay.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
a good pressure.
You're very dynamic, huh?
Okay. Go 180.
It's diving. Should we take a...
Okay. I'm going to go cine here.
Okay.
Inject.
Good.
is like okay. Zero 80. On the right.
Yeah.
80.
Yeah.
80.
Okay. Base 80.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, we have to recapture.
Yeah. We have to recapture, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to give a little one more scene. Okay. Die.
One thing is.
Yeah. Okay. It came out. Yeah. Okay.
Push
go.
It a little further.
Okay. Not to. Okay. 150 again, please. Pull back a little bit, don't get the pigtail.
So I pulled back. Okay. So when he's capturing, we don't want him to get in the
80
only.
Capture the pigtail. Yep, so now we are going down again.
Hmm. 150 again.
Yeah, I think you might have to advance a little, huh?
Yeah.
Be on the safe side.
You have to give some
now.
Die. Inject. Yep. Good. Okay.
Okay. Another three. Okay. 9 CCs have been given.
Okay.
180. Looks good.
Okay, 80. Now we are good. So what we do is you wait here a couple of minutes. Don't do anything. Wait. Let the PVC settle down.
Yep.
Let's see.
The final position.
How the valve behaves.
We are going to give only 2 CCs now whenever Dr. Keeney will tell us.
Yeah, we have to make sure we don't...
Yeah, it. Everything settled?
Not yet.
Need to
we are off pace, sir, right?
Yep.
Good.
You want to wire position is good?
Not yet. Okay, inject.
Good.
Yeah. Good.
Very good.
We are good.
I think five.
Okay, we are taking off the pigtail and then pull the wire back, center the wire. No, you're not.
Hmm?
Yeah.
A little bit more. Okay, good. Go release. Okay, we are going to go 180 again.
The valve went in.
Went in?
Yeah, it did. Look
yeah,
at
but
the
that's okay.
No, so it went deeper. It went deeper.
Huh?
He thinks
don't pace that. Don't pace that. Just 100. Do another die. Do another injection. You can see the die stain. The valve dove in.
Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Give 3 CC now. We have to do right. Inject? No, it
good,
did not.
Good, very good.
Okay. Yeah,
it's
okay.
Good. It's good.
Yeah, very
okay,
good.
Okay, all right. Good. Okay, 150. Neutral. Actually, 180. It's very high pressure. Very high. Ready?
Okay,
that's good.
Nice.
Okay, good. Okay. 120.
Pull the wire back.
Watch nose drum, watch nose.
More. Okay, good. Advance the wire. Okay, good.
Okay, 80.
Married. Okay.
Okay.
Now let's do the echo.
All right.
Yes.
Back up at 30 for a minute.
Very challenging.
Malcolm Anastasios is our echo fellow. He's going to show us a structural. Yeah.
Yeah.
Interventional echo.
Yeah.
Yeah, patient is very stable. Diastolic pressures are between 60 and 80, only in the post-PVCs. Good.
Great position of the valve.
You can hear?
No AI, no paravalvular leak, open the ventricle, nothing. Short axis. Short axis, nothing. The circle is perfect. Okay, let's go to the apex.
Okay. You good?
Look very good.
Okay.
And how is the EF? Some of the cases we have seen the acute improvement.
EF is a bit better, maybe 40%.
Good. From 33 went to 35 to went to 40% acutely. We have seen few cases actually.
No AI at all, no PVL at all.
Beautiful.
So keep it to get the velocity.
Pedro, you can appreciate the echo there?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's a beauty.
Yeah, you see.
I think
no, yeah,
three
yeah.
different projections, the long axis, the short axis, and oblique showing no AI.
You got it.
As you can see, peak velocity of 1.97 peak velocity. No pericardial effusion.
Beautiful.
I think the key now might be just to relate the diastolic with the LVDP.
We are going there now. Yep.
Yes. No single drop of PVL or
AI. All right, no PVL single drop. We like to hear that. Okay. All right, guys, let me go in now in the ventricle just to get our hemodynamic gradient.
No effusion. So everything looks great.
Okay. Still very hyperdynamic ventricle.
No gradient.
Okay. Now EDP has gone down to 10 and no gradient, as you can see there. So good. So we don't need to do any more. I know if we haven't met or you're not met, I mean, it's still okay. Because average contrast fusion or earlier publication was about 13 cc's will be about the same in this particular case. With a little bit, only thing they are going to do. And you see the EDP. EDP is like 12 from 18 down to, we can go 40 scale for LV, please. 50 scale for LV.
Good job.
Go to other transducer. Yeah. Good. It's about 10 to 12. Mission accomplished, and we are going to pull this one out now. Okay. Very good. Now, while we are going to complete my presentation of the current issue, Parushram and the team with our fellows, Sunny and Faisal, will close the with the
main access.
Main access, and going to use only one picture in the end, yes. Right? You have about 15 minutes while I'm discussing the current topic in this particular case. So you guys go ahead and do it. Right, Pedro, anything else? We just go over presentation.
You can move on. I think the fact of the matter is that you have no AI both by hemodynamics or by echo. So it's pretty safe to finish the case now.
Good. So perfect. Okay. So now, so what we do, we made the new topic now, that latest issues in the transcatheter structural heart interventions. And what I'm going to talk about, update in the antithrombotic therapy, post-TAVR or TAVI. Because we remember TAVI in Europe and TAVR in America. It is a popular TAVI European EU clinical trial. So what we know, that the combination, whether you have single antiplatelet therapy or DAPT or anticoagulation-based strategy, could be both vitamin K antagonist or NOAC, or both have plus and minus. Bleeding risk versus thromboembolism and structural wall deterioration. And there is no... Until now, there was no true randomized trial in various aspects, although some were there. And what we do at present, and those are the guidelines. Aspirin 81 milligram lifelong, you give a loading dose of 325 if your patient not on aspirin. And clopidogrel give a loading dose of 300 milligram and then 75 milligram daily for 3 to 5 months. 3 to 6 months has been recommended in various trials. Now, in order to look into this aspect of the antithrombotics, there are many trials which have been listed in this slide. And Galileo is the one which has been completed, and then the popular of the two types. And we'll discuss popular TAVI trial in a little more detail. And at present, NVSES, we are part of it, is ongoing at present. So Galileo was the first one to see the concept that patients who don't need anticoagulation, is giving anticoagulation NOAC in the rivaroxaban 10 milligram daily along with aspirin is better than your DAPT therapy for 90 days. And after that, they were all on single therapy, aspirin or rivaroxaban 10 milligram. And this basically trial, I showed both efficacy point of view, which is, and the safety point of view. And basically what we found, that clearly death or first thromboembolic event was significantly lower in the antiplatelet therapy group compared to anticoagulation group. And both all-cause death and bleeding. So clearly it was a negative trial or harmful trial. So recommendation became that if you have, you don't need a NOAC or oral anticoagulation should not be given. And this was basically, now, except there's one, I would say that the association which have been shown by giving anticoagulation, you decrease the leaflet deterioration. So reduced leaflet deterioration has been shown by multiple trials. The original data from Raj Makker and NEJM with the immobile leaflets by various, whether surgical or even tower. So that has really led to this separate leaflet thickening and mobility by 4D CT. So what have shown in the Galileo trial that yes, by giving the rivaroxaban, you decrease the structural valve deterioration, but at the cost of higher bleeding and higher death rate. So then there are various bleeding definitions. One is the Bleeding Academic Research Consortium, which are type 0 to type 5, and then the valve-related bleeding, published specifically for the valve-related VARC bleeding. Why these both BARC and VARC are important, because that's what the one of the important point which they have used in the popular TAVI trial. So background of the popular TAVI, which we knew based on all the guidelines, including ASA, AHA, that what we do at present, that is, despite the lack of evidence, a combination of low dose aspirin plus thinopyridine, particularly clopidogrel, after TAVI for 3 to 6 months is routinely done, followed by aspirin or a thinopyridine if they cannot tolerate aspirin lifelong. And this is what they did is, as a cohort A, the basically randomized patients to see whether you give aspirin alone or aspirin plus clopidogrel for 3 months. But these are the patients who did not need oral anticoagulation. The second point which we know in the guidelines, that patients with AFib, a combination of vitamin K antagonist and aspirin or thionopyridine is generally used for 3 to 6 months. So clearly those patients. So that was part of the cohort 2 or cohort B. That is, the patients who are oral anticoagulation, whether adding clopidogrel will be beneficial. So these are the two cohorts, cohort B and cohort A. Cohort B was the first presented in ACC this year with a simultaneous publication in NEJM and has looked into very simple aspect. Whether anticoagulation alone versus anticoagulation plus 3 months clopidogrel. Here, they left it whatever patient was taking oral anticoagulation. 65% took the warfarin, other 35% were on NOAC. But key, whatever it was continued, and then they were randomized to get 3 months of clopidogrel or not. And endpoints were bleeding and, of course, the from thromboembolic point of view, cardiovascular death, ischemic stroke, and MI. And this is a trial design of 330 patients and bleeding definition. Now, this is, I want to take a few seconds on this because that has come to a big criticism, the way the bleeding definitions were used in popular TAVI. The clearly they say we are going to use the VARC definition, but VARC does not define excess site or non-excess site bleeding. So therefore you say, okay, so let's go to the, we go with the BARC definition and the BARC type process related, they call as a BARC type 4. Which is the severe bleeding. And that's the severe bleeding basically is intracranial bleed, reoperation after closure of sternotomy, transfusion of 5 units of blood cells, or chest tube drainage. So this was the major BARC type bleeding 4. And then if it was non-procedure related, they say if you don't follow into type 4 is the one, everything else was the non-procedure related bleeding. So many of the bleedings which happened at the excess site of the TAVI site were in the by definition, non-procedure related bleeding, which to me was a little different, but that has been part of the criticism, but whatever it is, that is the uniform definition they used. Now, this is what I mentioned, 75 and 70% and so, NOAC versus so, and what they found clearly that the anticoagulation alone have a lower all bleeding, which is the blue versus red is the oral anticoagulation plus clopidogrel, all bleeding. Then secondary composite endpoint of the cardiovascular mortality, non-procedure bleeding, stroke and MI, again, significantly lower in the anticoagulation alone group. And if you take just the thromboembolic points, cardiovascular mortality, ischemic stroke or MI, again, were lower oral anticoagulation group. So basically what we learned, and these are the individual endpoints and particularly major life-threatening bleed were half in the oral anticoagulation versus oral anticoagulation plus clopidogrel. So very, very important. So basically we learned that clearly that if you don't have the patients who are on oral anticoagulation, if you don't have an indication for antiplatelet therapy, alone oral anticoagulation is good enough. And that is what we started using now. Right, Gilbert? That's what we... And
I know. I mean, unless there's an indication for antiplatelet agent, we just leave them on oral anticoagulation only in those patients.
We kind of have started, like, this is the ideal patient. This is, of course, not on anticoagulation, but question comes is that any patients which we are encountering now, and you are going to change your practice based on this study?
I would say, CAD incidence... who requires is about 25-30%. So those patients will remain on Plavix alone.
Yep.
Right? Plavix plus, with that and AFib, will probably add another 15% to that.
Yeah. So basically, point is that if you need an antiplatelet therapy for your basic disease process, which is most common being a CAD, you may need to. But otherwise, it makes sense. Although this is just the data yet. It has not been incorporated in the guideline, but it makes sense particularly. And you know what they did in the trial? Many of these patients, actually, they continue anticoagulation even during the TAVI procedure. Very interesting. And of course, then they kept the ACT a little lower and so on and so forth. But if the clopidogrel needed to be given and patient was should not have been, if they were already on, they stopped for 5 days, then they get 300 milligram loading dose day before or that morning, and then 75 milligram daily for 3 months plus minus 1 month. Could be 2 months or could be 4 months. Okay, so next point was... basically, this showed that with or without clopidogrel anticoagulation is better. Second question was, what about giving clopidogrel with aspirin? We don't have any randomized trial to show. A small trial did show aspirin alone was better compared to aspirin plus clopidogrel. That was like 70-patient trial. But this, the hypothesis of the cohort A was that aspirin alone compared to aspirin plus 3 months of clopidogrel is superior in terms of bleeding and having a no difference in the your secondary endpoint of thromboembolic event. So this is a trial, again, about 650 patients, aspirin alone or aspirin plus clopidogrel. In this particular case, what they did is, if your patient were on aspirin, they just gave 81 milligram aspirin on that same day and day before, and now no bolus was given or loading dose. If you're not on aspirin, before, then they gave 300 to 350 milligrams, so 325, I would say, in our scenario, as a loading dose day before or that morning, and then between 80 to 100 or 75 to 100 milligram daily continued. The other cases, clopidogrel was the same regime, that the patient got 300 milligram loading dose and then 75 milligram daily between 2 to 4 months after the TAVI procedure. And this is basically showed, and these are the majority were done with the transfemoral, and the valve was here 50% with the Sapien and 40% core valve. Now, very interesting, if you see, embolic device was used in single digits, less than 10%. That is what the trend in Europe. And what did we find? Kind of similar replica of cohort B. That is, that single therapy of aspirin alone in the blue bar had a lower bleeding compared to combination of aspirin plus clopidogrel. Again, mind it, these are the patients who did not have a recently stent, more than 3 months and so, and there is no clear indication for giving clopidogrel. Those patients showed that aspirin alone is good enough compared to the combination strategy. And this is the non-procedural bleeding, again, significantly lower in the aspirin group. And if you take the primary composite endpoint of the mortality, non-procedural bleeding, stroke, and MI, again lower. And the lastly, the thrombotic episode, you worry about that. What if you have the thromboembolism from the platelet thromboembolism from the valve? And basically, CV mortality, ischemic stroke, and MI was no different between two groups. So again, this study, these are the individual endpoints. The major life-threatening bleed, again, was decreased from 10.8 to 5% in the aspirin alone. Aspirin is a very good drug. So it reduced the rate of bleeding event, including major life-threatening or disabling bleeding, and does not increase rate of thromboembolic event. So it seems to be, if there's no indication of clopidogrel, like this particular case, more so one who has a liver disease, you're probably good enough by giving aspirin and no need to give clopidogrel. Although, they just minded, these are just the trial data, will make into the recommendation soon, but not present at this time. And so therefore, take home message, the popular TAVI trial cohort B showed that oral anticoagulation alone is superior without any difference in the thromboembolic events. And the cohort A showed that aspirin alone is superior without any increase in the thromboembolic events. So seems to be the single therapy in the patients who need NOAC or oral anticoagulation. You decide warfarin or NOAC, both were similar. Actually, there was a little, they showed it in the supplementary appendix that there was slightly better benefit with the NOAC compared to warfarin, but it was subgroup analysis, did not make any conclusion. But overall, that anticoagulation alone, no need for antiplatelet therapy, so should be alone. Patients who don't need antiplatelet therapy but not need anticoagulation, aspirin alone is good enough, and our case is the ideal case for that purpose. We're cirrhotic, so many things going on with this patient, the aspirin alone is reasonable to give this patient. Now let's come to our three questions quickly. Following the true statement regarding popular TAVI trial results, except OAC is superior to OAC plus clopidogrel in reducing owl bleeding. OAC is higher stroke rates versus OAC plus clopidogrel. OAC has similar thromboembolic rates versus OAC plus clopidogrel. And OAC has a lower non-peripheral bleeding versus OAC plus clopidogrel. Clearly, that there was no higher stroke rate with the OAC alone, very important. Second question, following the true statement regarding popular TAVI trial results, except aspirin alone has lower owl bleeding versus aspirin plus clopidogrel. Aspirin alone has similar thromboembolic event versus aspirin plus clopidogrel. Aspirin alone has higher stroke rates versus aspirin plus clopidogrel. And aspirin alone has similar life-threatening bleeding versus aspirin plus clopidogrel. Answer is C, that does not have any higher stroke rate compared to aspirin plus clopidogrel. The third question, the following are the true statement of Galileo trial, except higher two-year mortality in rivaroxaban group, higher major bleeding in rivaroxaban group, higher major bleeding and thromboembolic events in the rivaroxaban group, and higher structural valve deterioration in the rivaroxaban group. As we know, that rivaroxaban at least was protective from the valve deterioration, so D is the wrong answer. With that note, I finished my presentation, and now we are back here with Parashuram showing that the vascular access. Can we go back to the floor, please? You need to move the camera, viewers, or we are okay? That's it. So you see here, this is the last DSA done with another 3-4 cc's of dye, and full closure has been done. Yep. They can put the camera, show it to the ground. Yeah, shown there. Left side, no bleeding. Can we put the camera? Yeah, good. And just the last amount of dye given. So total dye used in this particular case is 15 cc's.
You guys want not to a single camera? RBC that's floating in the groin. You see that? Clean, like nothing was done. Good job, guys.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I think it's very important to highlight the point of bleeding that Dr. Sharma mentioned, because this patient is a liver patient, a CKD. You don't want any vascular issue here and closure, because any bleeding will increase the risk of AKI and potential liver decompensation. So it's really critical, this patient.
All right, Pedro. So from our side, we have completed our presentation and the case performance.
Fantastic. So thank you all to the heart team and the cardiac catheterization laboratory at Mount Sinai. And thank you for joining us today for this very exciting case. The recordings of the case will be available today at www.cccliveCases.org. Remember, our structural valve cases live are the second Tuesday every other month. So our next one is going to be Tuesday, November 10 at 9 a.m. I'll see you then. Thank you so much.